United's lights, camera, action, and cue the orchestra as the Big Red Book tells the story of one of the key figures from the silver screen. His name has appeared on the credits with many of the great screen idols, and he's still on the Hollywood A-list. Talking of gods, I'm in the gallery of the Royal Albert Hall, and far below me, one of the film industry's most prolific and respected composers is about to conduct the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. One of his melodies even supplied England's World Cup supporters with their very own soundtrack. He began composing more than 50 years ago, and so far he's produced unforgettable scores for more than 200 films and television series. The legendary Cecil B. DeMille gave him his first big break. Since then, generations of picturegoers have come out of the cinemas whistling his soundtracks. In films like The Magnificent Seven, his music has enriched some of the most dramatic moments in movie history.
He is a magnificent one. The man with the golden touch.
Before you make your own great escape, may I just add one final note? It comes in the form of a tribute, which is called Elmer Bernstein, Tonight, This Is Your Life.
Oh, for goodness. Well, obviously, this is a surprise.
We have a studio set up just a short cantata from here. So if you have the strength, and I know you have, and they're sorry to see you go, but we're going to tell your story this very night. You're coming as well. Excellent. Everybody back to our place. Thank you.
Well, what a thrill.
Great. I'll take the book and lead the way, and thank you for a wonderful evening.
Thank you.
Among the surprises in store for Elmer Bernstein, a Broadway buddy gets all lyrical. A star of the Oscar-winning Thoroughly Modern Millie puts his best foot forward, and friends fly in from Hollywood.
You guys can keep a great secret.
Elmer, tonight's wildly successful concert at the Albert Hall was part of the celebrations for your unbelievable 80th birthday year. Was that concert a special treat for you?
It was indeed. I was having so much fun, it was hard to concentrate.
We're greeting you, Con Brio here, a lively ensemble of friends and musicians, including Christopher Parkening and Cynthia Miller, plus, of course, your wife, Eve, and your daughters, Elizabeth and Emily. And just flown in from Los Angeles, your sons, Peter and Gregory.
Oh. Hello. Nice to see you in London.
One way or another.
And an extra surprise from California, four-time Oscar-winning songwriters, your friends Alan and Marilyn Bergman.
Just happened to be in the neighborhood.
I think that's surprising. I can't believe you all kept this secret.
So, Elmer Bernstein, This Is Your Life, and what a life. One film historian put it simply, Elmer Bernstein, he said, is film music. Your career has spanned the golden age of Hollywood into the 21st century. The figures are impressive enough. 151 film scores and 77 for television. Your honors include one Oscar, 12 Academy Award nominations, one Emmy, and two Golden Globes. Let's settle for a few old scores. The list of directors you've worked with is like a stroll down Hollywood Boulevard. But in the 70s, your career took an unexpected turn when you took a call from an old school chum of your son, Peter.
And when I first called you, Elmer, you were very confused.
He's flown in from Hollywood for you with the director of Blues Brothers, Animal House, and Trading Places, John Landis.
John.
So, John, what happened?
I had made my first studio film for Universal, my first traditional Hollywood movie, and it came time to compose the score, and the head of the music department asked me, you know, well, what composer would you like? I was very young, and the movie was sort of a college comedy, and I said, well, Elmer Bernstein. And the studio said, you know, expletive deleted, and then they said, who do you really want? I said, Elmer Bernstein, and they were like, Elmer Bernstein is like, Elmer Bernstein, you know, he's like, no, he's far too important for your movie and too expensive and forget it. And I said, let me call him. And they went, go ahead. And so I knew he'd take the call. So I called Elmer, who said, huh, why me? And I showed him the movie, and we discussed how to do it, and he did it. And the movie became, Animal House became very successful.
Well, John, actually, John's being modest now. John said, I had the idea that you should approach it as if it were a drama, you know, forget that it's a comedy. And it was a brilliant idea. It really was a trendsetter.
I think this situation absolutely requires a really futile and stupid gesture be done on somebody's part. We're just the guys to do it. Let's do it.
We've worked together many times, and it was a great honor and privilege when I was 27, and it's still a great honor and privilege, and he's one of the greats, and I'm lucky to know him.
John, thank you. A few words now from Academy Award nominated actor Edward Norton.
My fondest memory of working with Elmer probably from right at the beginning of our process of collaborating together on my film, Keeping the Faith. Elmer was nice enough to watch the movie. I had come to him and asked him if he would compose the music for it. And he came and said, you know, it's a wonderful film and I really love it and the characters are so rich, I'd love to do the music. And I said, well, that's thrilling. The only problem is that I only have about 4 weeks before I have to lay the score down. And Elmer threw up his hands and went, 4 weeks, that's impossible. And then he rubbed his hands together and said, okay, so let's do it. I hope that I have one-fifth of your passion, Elmer, 10 years from now, let alone 50 years from now. Thanks very much, and congratulations. I hope to see you soon.
Back to the screenplay. I don't know whether you wrote anything for the occasion, but you were born on April the 4th, 1922, in Brooklyn, New York. You're the only child of Edward and Selma Bernstein, immigrants from Central Europe. Your father taught English literature at high school. And as a young woman, your mother had been a dancer. As a boy, you have a selection of talents to choose from. You would perform on stage as a dancer, and you win several prizes for painting. But it was soon clear that your greatest talent was music and the piano.
And I was the girl next door who kept interrupting your piano practice.
You've known her for more than 70 years, and she's flown in from New York, Dorothy Greenberg.
You knew I was coming, right?
Yeah, I knew you were coming here, but not there. Great life, huh?
All right, break it up, you kids. Dorothy, Elmer learned to play in spite of you.
He did. When I was 8 and you were 9, and I lived in a house on the hill in Woodstock, New York, where we met, and you lived in a cabin in the woods.
That's right.
I could hear you practicing scales in the morning. And I don't know how I had the courage, but I would walk through the field and yell to your mother, "Can Elmer come out and play?" And for some reason, she said yes.
You were the only person that ever rescued me.
That was the start of our friendship.
That's right.
It really was.
That's right.
And now, you have a house on the hill in Woodstock. I have a cabin in the woods. And I still call you and say, "Elmer, can you come out and play?"
Anytime.
I love you forever.
I love you.
Thank you very much. You give your first concert at the age of 15, but the war interrupts your career. You join up and you work as an arranger of folk music for Glenn Miller and the Army Air Force Band. In 1950, you move to the West Coast to write film scores, and 5 years later, you get an introduction to the great Cecil B. DeMille. He was working on his biblical epic, The Ten Commandments. Now, when you were first discussing the music for the film, what was the great man's first question?
He said, "Do you think he could do for ancient Egyptian music what Puccini did for Japanese music and Madame Butterfly?" That was the opening line. I gave a good answer. For him, it was the only answer that would have kept me in the studio, as I found out later. And I said, I really don't know, but I'd like to try. And that was it.
Well, the man who would always be remembered for playing Moses in DeMille's biblical epic is, as you know, battling heroically against illness, but he talks to you by satellite telephone. Charlton Heston.
Good evening, Elmer. Charlton Heston here. I hope that you and all your family and friends are having a wonderful evening. You once said that you owe Cecil B. DeMille everything for giving you the opportunity to write the score for his biblical epic, The Ten Commandments. I could say exactly the same thing, because in offering me the role of Moses in that wonderful movie, he gave me my big chance, too. Whenever I see that film again, I'm always in awe at the magnificence of the music you wrote for it. The value of your score is almost impossible to measure. It's absolutely perfect for the film. Although you were a young composer then with limited experience, your music guided the emotional shape of each scene with mature mastery. For both of us, The Ten Commandments was a breakthrough assignment. And since then, you've gone on to create a brilliant portfolio of work that will live on for as long as people continue to love the movies. Elmer, my dear friend, I salute you and wish you well in everything you do, now and in the future.
The Frank Sinatra film, The Man with the Golden Arm, wins you your first Oscar nomination and launches a series of jazz-oriented scores, including Sweet Smell of Success and Walk on the Wild Side. You provide romantic melodies for the film The View from Pompey's Head. We knew it here as Secret Interlude. The leading actress has become a dear friend over to the Ojai Valley in California, and Donna Winter.
Oh, my goodness.
I play something of yours, Elmer, almost every day. and strangely found myself in tears. And I tried to figure out what that was, and I think I know now, that everything you write has a solid base of emotion. And I think you write like a man who is permanently in love. Thank you, Cheshire, for enriching the world with your beautiful music from a very beautiful man.
In 1960, you create the definitive anthem for Westerns. Your music for John Sturges' The Magnificent Seven stays in the mind more than 40 years later. The nasty bandit in that film was an established stage actor who also did many more films, such as How the West Was Won and The Godfather Part III. A few well-chosen words now from Eli Wallach.
Hello, Elmer. Remember me? The Magnificent Seven? 40 years ago. Any resemblance between that fiery head bandit and me is purely coincidental. In the old days, in silent films, they used to have music played on the set to enhance the emotional level of the actor. We didn't have that while we were filming The Magnificent Seven. The director once said to me, "Why do you type when you're riding your horse?" I said, "What do you mean type?" He said, "You're holding the reins correctly in your right hand, and this hand goes up and down like so." I said, "I'll stop." When I went to the world premiere, I heard your music for the first time. I wish I'd heard it while I was riding that horse. I wouldn't have typed. I'd have sat up tall in the saddle and looked like a head bandit. Elmer, take a tip. Relax tonight. Smile. That's it.
Eli Wallach, now Magnificent 87. Business keeps you young, obviously. Earlier, we caught a burst of your theme from The Great Escape. That jaunty march has found a new lease of life as the theme tune for England football supporters. This is how it sounds in the hands of the England Supporters Club Brass Band. They think it's all over. It is now. Elmer, you're among friends. Did you enjoy that?
Oh, yes, I did.
Elmer, your scores have ranged across an enormous variety of film styles, but it was your work on the musical comedy Thoroughly Modern Millie that in 1967 won you an Oscar.
I have to be back by 10:30.
You betcha.
Yeah.
That musical left a lasting impression on its leading man.
I love driving on the wrong side of the road, don't you?
Terrific.
It's the thoroughly British James Fox. Oh.
What a judgment.
Nice to see you.
It's great to see you.
This is an honor.
James, what does Elmer's music do for you?
Elmer, you have given me the most memorable experiences in film music, really. And I would like to dedicate, if I may, a little dance sequence, the tapioca, from Thoroughly Modern Millie. If you'll remember, my chat-up line to Julie Andrews was, "I was just going nowhere killing time when I heard your snappy music."
Snappy music.
Your
yes.
Snappy music? Yeah. And he goes, "Tap, tap, 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 slap. Slap, 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 slap yoker, dap you, dap the dappier, flappers, flap, flap, flappier, everyone gets happier when you do the tap, tap yoker, when you do the slap, slap yoker, da."
Bravo!
Wouldn't have believed that if I hadn't seen it. Well, your reputation as a master of Western scores leads to a long association with John Wayne. In 1967, you work on True Grit, which earned you another Oscar nomination.
One day, little girl, the sadness will leave your face.
The man who wrote the words for that song also worked with you on the film Gold and the Tony-nominated Broadway musical Merlin.
But Elmer, on Merlin, we labored under a severe handicap. Our leading man couldn't sing.
He's got his own Oscar and a couple of Tonys with his wife Shirley, our own Don Black. So, Don, you had a problem. The show's Merlin, but no wizard singer.
Yeah, our leading man was a triple threat, really. He, he couldn't sing, dance, or act. And as it was a musical, it was a bit of a problem.
It was a slight problem.
He was a terrific illusionist and magician. He could turn a woman into a panther. He could saw a man in 20 different pieces. But I'll never forget what Shirley said the night after we opened. She said,
"It's a shame he couldn't make the critics disappear."
Which is a great line. Elmer, you are not just a part of movie history. You are movie history. You are an incredible man. This man has become more than a friend to me. He's become a role model. You know, sometimes you meet someone in your life who makes you look at life differently. And such a man is Elmer Bernstein. But my favorite story about you has to be the one about the Hollywood producer, a young kid of about 19, just a few years ago, who wanted to meet Elmer and talk about an assignment. And I think Elmer had shirts older than this guy. And this kid started the meeting off. He said, "Mr. Bernstein, what have you done?" And Elmer looked at him and said, "You first." We love you, Tony.
Your catalogue of hits includes collaborations with Martin Scorsese. The elegant music for The Age of Innocence earned an Oscar nomination in 1993. And then there was your lyrical Irish score for My Left Foot.
Give us one of them flowers, Mom.
The producer who invited you to write the score for My Left Foot first met you in 1974 when you made a flying visit to Dublin.
And Elmer, that's what I made you work the night shift.
He secretly flew in from Ireland for your birthday concert, and he's here now, Noel Pearson.
So finally we meet.
So we're talking about a little night music, are we?
I was in Brazil at a music festival, and Henry Mancini was the chairman of the judges, and we all were wishing each other goodbye, and I says to him, "What are you doing?" He says, "Well, I'm going to be in London in a couple of weeks, and maybe we could meet, because Elmer and I are doing a concert in London." So I was very young. I said, "How about coming to Dublin?" And Mancini says to Elmer, "Dublin, where can we play in Dublin?" So I said, "Leave everything to me, everything will be fine." So I went back to Dublin, went around trying to get a venue. I went to this one theater, which was owned by Eamon Andrews at the time, and I said to him, "Can we not have the Monday night? It's the only night these guys are free." He said, "No, we can't close." So I said, "What do you do when the show closes?" He said, "Everybody goes home." I said, "I'll rent the place." So I said to Elmer, "Listen, there's a little kind of, it's, you know, an old Irish custom, you know." "We have a whole series of midnight concerts here." And Henry Mancini said, "This guy is definitely nuts. How are they going to get anybody to come out at midnight?" Of course, the show was a huge success. It was packed, and think we ended at about 10 o'clock the next morning, you know. So about 15 years later, I said to him, I got to make this film. I said, you remember the guy that we met in this hotel bar was in the wheelchair? So we're going to make a film on his life. It's Christy Brown. He said, it's on me. So he did the score for my left foot because we had no money anyway, you know. And the rest was history.
But thank you, though. Bye. Elmer, you've embarked on your ninth decade and you're still making music. You've just finished work on Todd Haynes' Far From Heaven and Scorsese's Gangs of New York. You've created a body of work that is unique in volume and quality. And who better to pay tribute than a great friend who's in the same line of work? Like you, his credits are phenomenal. Jaws, Star Wars, E.T., Schindler's List. That gives you a clue. From his office in the DreamWorks studio, greetings from John Williams.
Oh, my goodness. Elmer, I'm so happy to be able to join all these people that are celebrating you tonight. We're all so proud of you. And what I'm particularly proud of, Elmer, is that you and I have had such a long association in music and as friends that you hired me as a pianist for your orchestra early on in my career for films like Sweet Smell of Success and To Kill a Mockingbird and The Magnificent Seven. I remember playing in the orchestra for you all those years ago. And we were enormously proud of you then, and we are still. Your achievements over the decades have been remarkable. And this kind of celebration is something that you not only deserve and merit, but it's long overdue, and I'm just happy to join everyone else and salute you. Just say bravo, Elmer, on a magnificent career and an exemplary life in music.
Well, Elmer, by general agreement, you've had enough careers for several men, and there's obviously more to come. Our final entrance tonight is reserved for another prolific composer who's known and admired your work since you first arrived on the West Coast 52 years ago.
Elmer, you were 28, and I was your first friend in Hollywood.
Just arrived from Los Angeles, and still the best of buddies, Herschel Gilbert.
Surprise!
Yeah.
Somebody older than me.
That's your surprise, right?
Yeah.
Surprise!
Thank the
worst.
You know, something hasn't been said tonight. You have what rarely composers have, even motion pictures, and that's a certain style. People recognize that style in any kind of picture you do. And for that, you know, Trudy and I watch The Late Show, and we always guessed at the main title, who was the composer? We guess you 99% of the time. So congratulations and good luck.
I'm a Bernstein. This is your life.
It's EastEnders next tonight on BBC One, and Peggy's giving Phil relationship tips. Oh, the master at work. And looking ahead to Saturday night, Piers Brosnan is the rich playboy in the Thomas Crown Affair. Big movie at 9.
Biggest fans, a resident of Albert Square, is a signed-up member of the Archers Appreciation Society, and she sends you this greeting, Wendy Richard.
Hi, Charles. Hi, Judy. I'm so thrilled to be part of your special night. Weren't Angela Rippon and I right? You are the sexiest man in show business. What a rascal Brian is. You've had us all on the edge of our seats. Would Jennifer find out about the baby, or wouldn't she? It's been a fantastic storyline for you. Well, I've thought of another one. I think Jennifer ought to organise a soap actress to come and open Ambridge Summer Fete. I've got the countryside dog, the four-wheel drive, the barber coat, the wellies, everything. Just waiting for the call. Have a splendid evening, Charles. It's a well-deserved tribute to you. God bless.
Yeah. The other famous admirer Wendy mentioned actually joins the cast of The Archers to play one of Nelson Gabriel's upmarket girlfriends, and she's here to report on that, Angela Rippon. Did you actually have any scenes with our hero?
I'm afraid I didn't. As you said, I was playing Nelson Gabriel's girlfriend, Penelope, from Chelsea. And the only people I was allowed to meet in Ambridge were the Grundys. And Penelope didn't rate them at all. But, I mean, you and I have met so many times socially. I really think it's a shame that Penelope did not meet Brian Aldridge, because she was a flighty bit. And I suspect that, given the opportunity to meet the old rogue here, she would have actually set her cap at him. And I think that she might have given Jennifer a few sleepless nights way beyond anything that happened with Sharon.
Stick around, darling, stick around.
There's still time.
Angela, thank you.
Thank you, darling, so much.
Michael Burke, you're a friend of Charles, and you say he's good news.
He's hot news. Actually, more than that, what he's been up to recently, he's been more of a kind of moral maze, really. but he's, and now he's our greatest living Englishman. He's a hangover from a gentler, wittier, kinder age. And he's also the last Englishman to wear a cravat.
I'll tell you what, also, Charles, you, Angela, Michael Burke and I have something in common, apart from lovely legs. We have all read the news for the BBC.
This is true, yes. I did for a time read the news on the World Service until I was doing my... Well, it ended up to be my last shift. It was the 1 o'clock news on the World Service. And I was sitting in the green room at midnight, and John Wing, who was a very distinguished newsreader, walked in. He said, "I pity the man who's doing the 1 o'clock." So I rather listened. He said, "'Cause there's been a coup in Czechoslovakia, and they've named the new cabinet." I'm afraid that bulletin overran rather a lot of time, and that was enough news reading for me, really.
Went on to be a football commentator. Now, let's get to the man behind the mask. Charles Henry Collingwood, this is your life.
You.
You're a descendant of Admiral Cuthbert Collingwood, Horatio Nelson's second in command at the Battle of Trafalgar. You were born in St. John, New Brunswick, Canada, on May the 31st, 1943. Your father, Jack, an RAF pilot, was stationed there as a wartime flying instructor. When you were 15 months old, you and your mother, Molly, braved the German U-boats to return to England. Your parents sent you to St. Neot's Prep School in Eversley, Hampshire, where you become head boy. And there you are, in a production of HMS Pinafore, looking like the head girl. What would Admiral Collingwood have made of that?
You'd have approved, I think.
When you were a boy, one of the highlights of the year was the annual family holiday with your parents to West Wittering. You rented a cottage next door to Mary Correll. Mary, you've known Charles since he was 8 years old.
Yes, indeed, and all the family, and they were great friends.
It's a long time ago, isn't it, Mary? Mary is now 165. And Mary has been a real friend for many, many years, and she's a star in her own right, Mary.
Well, I can see that. When you're 13, you become a boarder in Westcott House at Sherburne School in Dorset. And that's where we go now, with an old pal who went on to become a colonel in the Scots Guards, Jeremy Cox.
You'll recognise this place instantly. It's your old alma mater. School to you, Charlie. Sherburne School. You spent 4 years here, distinguished not so much by your academic brilliance, but by your priceless gift of being able to make the rest of the boys laugh. You've been back here a couple of times recently, Charlie, and there was a famous occasion a couple of years ago when you were reputed to say, when you were talking to the boys in the big schoolroom over there, that your best mate was a chap called Jeremy Cox, and he was only your best mate because he was the only chap in the school as stupid as you. Actually, as me. The cricket pavilion hasn't changed much since you were here, Charlie. The master who ran the coats in your time wants a word. Mike Earls Davis.
Hello, Charles. You know, it's hard to credit that it's nearly 50 years since you were a tearaway whirlwind fast bowler in the Colts 11. I can still see that wounded expression on your face as yet another of your ear-splitting appeals was turned down by the umpire.
Hi, Charlie. Richard Gould. We were in the same first 11 cricket side in, dare I say it, 1960. Charles, do you
recognize this piano. It was in your boarding house dining room. You were a very talented jazz player, and still are, I imagine. Jazz was banned by your housemaster. But one evening, thinking that both the housemaster and his wife were out, you embarked on your full repertoire. Halfway through, however, you turned round and saw, in the hallway, the housemaster and his wife bopping away.
Since then, of course, Charlie, you've gone on to entertain millions. Have a wonderful evening, and from all your friends at Sherburn, lots of love and the very best wishes.
And thanks for that sit rep to Jeremy Cox and Richard Gould, here together with another chum from your days at Sherburn, Daily Mail columnist Nigel Dempster. Nigel, any choice tidbits?
Well, until you've seen Charles Collingwood, as we called him, Collingwood in those days, in his short shorts, you ain't seen nothing.
When you went to Sherburn, the thing was you had to be a chap. You didn't have to be very clever or anything, but if you were a chap, you were good. You know, you get on the
start.
World. Yes, you're a chap. And they used to say, Collingwood, you're a chap. And Dempster is very bitter about this because to this day he rings me up and he says, the difference between you and me, you see, I'm not a chap, Charles, but you're a chap.
I was a chap.
No, I... In your own opinion, yes. You're a terrific chap. They're all terrific chaps.
In 1963, at the age of 20, you do what none of your illustrious forebears has ever done. You win a place at the Royal Academy of Dramatic Art. Also there, building his character, was that fine actor, Ronald Pickup.
I'm so glad to be here as part of the story of your life. When we were here, we only did one play together, and we've never acted together since. Perhaps it was as well, because I remember myself being very stern as the Duke in Measure for Measure, and I remember you being amazingly comic. I want to celebrate not only your great talent as an actor, but your great talent for friendship. And I mentioned very briefly, because I know it will embarrass you, our old friend Lish, Miss Hilda Lishman, who was your landlady when you were here at RADA, and whom you introduced me to, and I became a friend of hers as well. Your friendship, however, continued for some 35 years after we left RADA. You looked after her as a son might look after his mother. You were the family she never had. Although she had a host of friends, you were the one who looked after her, gave her security, and gave her tremendous fun and laughter. I celebrate you for that, as I celebrate everything about you for tonight.
First stop after RADA was the Everyman Theatre, Liverpool. Then comes a season in rep at the Marlowe Theatre in Canterbury.
And Charles, that's when you displayed your cardinal virtues.
A Canterbury tale from your good friend, Richard Stilgo. Richard, I know you've got plenty of memories to choose from.
This was, I think, my second job, Charles's second job, early 20s, and we were rehearsing Beyond the Fringe. And because Charles was a proper actor, he was also in a play, because it was repertory, in the evening, and it was Hadrian the Seventh, wasn't it? Which is a very good play about the Pope. And Charles was playing a cardinal, and there were eight cardinals, and there's a big scene in the first act where they all come in through the audience, so they all had to wait in the foyer dressed as cardinals. And our director for Beyond the Fringe was a little Canadian bloke, about that big, called Burt Lancaster.
We were so excited when
heard it was going to be Burt Lancaster, but it was this one, that size.
Yeah.
And because he was rehearsing us in the afternoon and that not in the evening, he went to see Hadrian the Seventh, and he got terribly excited by it and fainted during the first act. And a couple of the usherettes picked him up and carried him into the foyer and laid him down gently. And when he came round, he looked up, and there were eight cardinals looking down at him, and Charles said, "Hello, welcome to heaven." And he passed out. We never saw him again. And then we got to know each other, and Charles was best man for Annabelle's and my wedding. And for years and years, I wrote not very funny leaden radio scripts. And the great, great joy of this man is you give a leaden radio script to him, and immediately it becomes gold. Those of you who only know him as Brian Aldridge don't know one of the funniest actors of his generation. I do hope you see Rory again.
A radio audiences have to use their imagination to picture the characters. Luckily, you've done plenty of television work as well, so let's add a bit of makeup to the voice.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm all of a theatrical tingle tonight.
Oh, come on, Jim, you don't really want to stay.
Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Now stop being so selfish.
Have you ever heard such tripe in all your life?
Listen, my dear, you can't stay here all alone. And no one's coming to see you.
I don't understand.
Dead? Excuse me. Rafe. Husband, poor chap's brown bread.
Are you sure?
This is his wake, apparently. Thought it was too late to cancel.
We shouldn't really impose on the poor.
Waiter. Waiter, this is delicious. Could I have a drum roll?
In the late 70s, another demanding role. You had to keep a straight face for a whole series of a show called Under Manning.
Hello, Charles. You're going to say when you see me, you've put a lot of weight on. But I've had a lot on my plate just lately.
As large as life, Bernard Manning.
Thank you.
Go on, destroy me.
No. Those see-through wigs are very nice. Happy days. Happy
and
days.
You. It's good to see you.
I'm feeling a treat. I'm on 16 tablets a day.
Aye.
Three needles with the diabetes.
Yeah.
Deaf in his left ear.
Yeah.
Angina. And I get up in the morning and put my elbows out like that.
Yeah.
If I don't feel wood, I know I'm right for another day.
Right. He used to say to me, do you know, Charles, he said, I go home at the end of the week and my wife says, he's talking bosh, you're catching it off that chair.
Oh, that's right.
And I used to say to you, do you know, it's funny, my wife says just the opposite.
They were good days, Bernard. They were
wonderful.
Good days.
Lovely to be here.
And you're nice.
You
to
deserve
see
this. And you've got a wonderful family. Hello, Judy. Isn't she betting the old bag you used to bring in the embassy? The case is getting better. Thanks on all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Bernard. Now, you'd met Judy while making Noises Boff. In 1976, you marry at Wood Green Register Office in North London. Judy, would you say that your husband is a romantic man?
Yes, very romantic. A few years ago now, I had a very special birthday. I wanted a new car. And I hoped and hoped and hoped. Anyway, on my birthday morning, knock at the front door, woman there with this beautiful balloon. And I thought, wow, a balloon. But inside the balloon was a car key. And we went round to our garage, and there was my beautiful silver car, all dressed in pink and silver ribbon. So that was very special. Mm.
That was very touching. you've both been married before, and Charles helps to raise your two sons. Toby, you remember beach holidays?
Indeed, I do. We used to spend many summers on holiday as a family down in West Wittering. And for those who know it, when the tide goes out, it exposes a large amount of sand, which is perfect playing surface for cricket. And Dad used to organise every family he could come across, really, on the beach to come and join in. And before long, we had a really competitive, almost test match type standard match taking place. It was a bit like a battle for the ashes, but we had a great time, really enjoyed it.
A bit more satisfying than that.
Absolutely, yes, definitely.
Cricket is a very important thing. One of your happiest roles is being president of the Stage Cricket Club. You were their captain over four decades. Some of your teammates, stars of stage screen and hair cream adverts, are here. Now, Jane, you weren't so mad on cricket, but you have gone into the family business.
I have, and Dad is very supportive. When I was younger, I was in a show at school. About 20 minutes before the show was due to go up, the girl who was playing a male teacher in the show got sick. So I phoned up Dad. I said, Dad, you've got to be in the play. And he was coming along with my grandparents as well. So he arrived and he put on a teacher's gown and he got a clipboard and the script and came on stage with me, and we acted together, and so it was nice that Granny and Grandpa got to see us both together, and hope we can do it again.
Yeah. Now, when you and Judy were courting, this became your favourite song.
You're a lady, I'm a man, you're supposed to understand.
You're a Lady, one of the great hits of the 70s. Eventually, you asked your friend, Richard Stilgo, to arrange a meeting with the man who created that song.
And the first thing you did, Charles, was to stand on my hand.
For some reason, he's still a good friend, Peter Skellern. So, Peter, you offered the hand of friendship.
We were sitting around on the floor at Annabelle and Dickie's house. I didn't got any furniture then, I think. And and you were saying wonderful things about this song. How it was sort of part of it was your song, part of your romance.
I meant them.
Gushing. Yeah. I know you did. Then he stood up to get a drink and trod on my hand. And you were sweetly mortified, which I was glad about. And I also remember you became a true friend. But I bought a boat. I used to do a lot of sailing, and I bought a small yacht. Nothing grand, a small yacht in Scotland.
Very small.
Yes, it was. And then I asked a few chums if they would help me sail it down to Cornwall, where I live. Charles had, even though he's descended from Admiral Collingwood, had never sailed. Never sailed. But he said
you
he was...
You say sailor and you put your arm around it.
He said he'd come down with us. The night before we left Scotland, it was Charles's birthday, and we had our meal in the hotel. We also arranged a birthday cake. And the next morning, we left about 6 o'clock in the morning, and it was a nice day, but it was a sort of long, loping swell, if I remember right. And Charles started telling his stories, as he does, and about an hour later, he went white and threw up over the side, the birthday cake all over the sea. And every 2 or 3 hours, I'd make sandwiches and pass them up. Everyone wolfed the sandwiches down. Charles would eat his and throw up over the side. By about the fifth time, the end of this day, I'm making more sandwiches, and Charles watched me lovingly make this sandwich and pass it up to you. He took it and threw it straight over the side. I said, Charles, why have you done that? He said, well, in 2 minutes, that's where it's going to be. I'm just cutting out the middleman.
Thank you, Peter, for this.
Thank you.
From time to time in the Archers, real life gets tangled up with the storytelling. You've had several distinguished guests at Ambridge. On one occasion, Radio Borsetshire had its own Antiques Roadshow.
I may be your greatest fan, Charles, but I have to tell you the honest truth.
His decision is final. The highly valued Henry Sandon. Ah.
Nice to see you.
Henry, you want to look out for a genuine article.
Well, they're always, but they very, very generously, the artists allowed me to be in an episode with them. And I had to be the resident expert on a Radio Borsetshire Antiques Roadshow from Ambridge Village Hall. And the finest piece that was going to be presented to me to value was going to be your grandfather clock. Do you remember it?
Yes.
And you brought it along thinking it was marvellous. And I had to tell you that it was a complete fake. Bought from Nelson Gabriel.
Ah. But he was wonderful, and he came on. The only thing was because he had to read the script and do, you know, radio acting, and it bothered us actors so much because he was so damn good.
Yes. You also came to one of the real genuine antiques roadshows, didn't you, at the Victoria and Albert Museum, and brought some of your great treasures of the family.
Yes.
And I have to tell you, those were wrong as well. But you were very generous about it all and didn't blame me. And also, one admires your work over the years on the artist, especially. We live near Ambridge, my wife and I, and she always says that you've given her great pleasure over the years. And and also to thousands and thousands of ladies all around the world. Including Siobhan.
Oh, well, thank God for radio.
So carry on with your wonderful nut brown voice for
Henry.
Years to come. Great to see you.
Thank you so much.
Well, it's almost time to close this episode and bring in the dum-dee-dum-dee-dum-dee-dum. But I must tell you that when I introduced your son Barney, who's travelled here from southern Spain, I forgot to tell you that because he doesn't care to fly, it took him 30 hours to get to London by train. But Barney didn't come alone. His wife Sarah is here with their children Amber and Caius, and with Toby's wife Steph, your two other grandchildren, twins Olivia and Megan. Oh.
Judy couldn't say, hello, darlings. Isn't it wonderful?
Charles Collingwood, this is your life.
Hi, good. Thank you very much. That's very good.
From Ambridge to Albert Square, next on BBC One, Derek's getting the cold shoulder in EastEnders.